impacted tooth. Now about impacted tooth, everything about it, like what are the indications, contraindication, that etiology, definition, classification and everything, I have talked in my last video for impaction. So starting off with the main topic, that is the surgical removal of the impacted tooth. So before this surgical removal, you need to do the assessment of the tooth.
So about this assessment, I'm going to make a video which I'm posting on the Instagram page.
So these all are the steps in the surgical removal of an impacted tooth. So first is asepsis and isolation, then local anesthesia, then you're giving an incision, then reflection of a mucoperiosteal flap, then there is bone removal, sectioning of the tooth, elevation, extraction, then you're debriding the area, controlling of bleeding, that is hemostasis, then you're closing that area, that is suturing, then you're giving the post-operative instruction, medication, and the last one is follow-up. So I'm going to explain all this step and where all the differences are in impacted canine, in impacted molar, maxillary and the mandibular. It basically lines with this step, that is this incision instruments that are used in the surgical removal of the impacted tooth. So first is mouth mirror, second is probe, third is you're using a number 15 blade on a bar, on a BP handle, that is Bard Parker handle. Then you're using artery forceps, and it can be mosquito artery forceps, then retractors to retract the mouth. Then you are using chisel, burr, and burr is straight fissure and rose head. Then you are using elevators, forceps to remove the tooth. Then there is bone file for the smoothing of the bone, needle holder, tissue forceps, scissor. Then you're using drape and syringe. So these all are the instruments that you're using for the impacted tooth. So this is the diagram. As you can see now, these all are the instruments that are used. So now starting off with the first, that is asepsis and isolation. So in asepsis and isolation, what you're doing is scrubbing and painting. So basically you're preparing the patient and you're preparing yourself for the procedure. For scrubbing and painting of the skin and the oral mucosa, what you're using is Cetrimid plus absolute alcohol plus povidone plus iodine, or you can use Cetrimid plus absolute alcohol plus chlorhexidine. So this is the solutions that you use for the scrubbing and painting of the skin and the oral mucosa. So what you are doing in scrubbing and painting is, now you are making this solution, and then this is suppose the face, nose. Then what you're doing is, you're taking a cotton which is dipped in this solution, and then with the help of the forceps, you're holding that cotton and then you're just moving it from the midline towards the side of this face. And make it a point that when you're painting, you're not coming back to the midline. So once you're going from the midline till the end of the ear, like that, you're extending this till the neck. So this is how you're going to do the painting, so that this area is, it like, it becomes free of any organisms or any, so there is no risk of infection which can happen. The next is cleaning solutions. So there are cleaning solutions which are used on skin to remove the residual soap solution. So what you can use is normal saline, alcohol. So these are the things, alcohol, spirit. Then painting solution, they act topically to inhibit the further growth of the microorganisms. The painting solution mostly are povidone, iodine. It is a 5% solution for skin, and for oral mucosa it is 1% solution. Then chlorhexidine, gluconate, it is 7.5% for skin, and it is 0.2% as a rinsing oral cavity. And then you're draping the patient like with the drape, and you're just clipping it. And this is the first step, that is the asepsis and isolation. The next one is the local anesthesia. Now depending upon which tooth you're removing, so the local anesthesia, it will differ. So local anesthesia for mandibular, for example, if it is for mandibular, molars and canine, then you're using pterygomandibular nerve block. After that, if it is for maxillary canines, you're using infraorbital nerve block, and even you're giving a palatal infiltration of the incisive canal, and there is bilateral palatal nerve block. So these all are for the maxillary canine. And if it is for maxillary molar, then you're giving PSA, that is posterior superior alveolar nerve block, and palatine nerve block or infiltration. So these all are the techniques for local anesthesia. Now the next is the incision. So incision is nothing but the flap design. Now what are the principles of incision? The first principle is the incision, it should be away from the surgical site. It should be away from the surgical site. Then it should not be on vital structures. It should be perpendicular to the tissue. And a triangular flap is usually recommended for an adequate blood supply. So these all are the various principles of incision. So now for mandibular molars, the incision that we use is triangular or envelope. So now in triangular, this is a triangular type of flap or triangular type of incision, in which this flap, it begins at the anterior border of the ramus, that is the external oblique ridge, and it extends as far as the distal aspect of the second molar. So this is your second molar, so it extends to the distal aspect of the second molar. So this is your incision. It starts from the anterior border of the ramus and it extends till the distal border of the, so the distal aspect of the second molar. Now this is like why the vertical releasing, so this is your vertical releasing incision. It is made obliquely downwards and forwards, and it ends in the vestibular fold. So basically it's like, now this is your incision which is given. Now when you're raising a flap, so after this incision you raise a flap. So this is basically how you raise a flap after it. So this is how you raise a flap. Now there is this bone which is covered, and then there is this impacted tooth below it. So this, now the flap, it is raised, is in the triangular shape. So this is known as triangular incision. Now it has a modification. For example, if the impacted tooth, it is like present deeply. So in that, what you're doing is, now you're giving this, so you extend your incision from the anterior border of the ramus, and instead of this vertical, so anterior releasing incision, what you do is you involve the second molar's crevice, and then you give this releasing incision, anterior releasing incision. So your triangular, it was like this. But now if the molar, it is deeply impacted, then you are even involving this second molar's crevice, and then you're giving this releasing incision, anterior releasing incision. And this is how your triangular flaps are. So again, when you're raising a flap, so this is basically how it follows. So now this is, and then you're raising a flap, and then you'll see the bone, and under it, that is this impacted tooth. Now what is this envelope? Envelope is nothing but the horizontal flap. So in your tooth, so this is your impacted tooth, this is the second molar, this is the first molar. So in this envelope or the horizontal flap, what you're doing is, now the incision, it begins at the anterior border of the ramus. So this is your anterior border. So it starts from the anterior border of the ramus and it extends as far as the distal aspect of the second molar. So your this first incision, it extends till the distal aspect of the second molar. Then it continues along the cervical line of the last two teeth. So it is like this. So it is extending from the anterior border of ramus and like this of the last two teeth which are present, and it extends, so like basically it extends till this, and it ends in the mesial aspect of the first molar. So this type of flap, it is usually used where the impaction is relatively superficial. So now in this case, now in this, your impacted tooth, it was present deeply. Now this is the superficial where it is about to erupt, but it is like a bit impacted. So this is the case, this is the envelope type of incision. And these are the incision that you are using for the mandibular molar. And for the maxillary molars, you are using a triangular incision. So basically this is your second molar, this is your first molar. So this is how your triangular flap is. So when you're raising your flap, so this is how it looks. So this is a triangular flap. So this is nothing but a triangular incision. Now, which are the incision that you use for canines? So now canines, as we have seen, they are buccally placed and palatally placed. So if they are buccally placed, then we can use semilunar, trapezoidal. So these are the incisions that you use if it is buccally impacted. If your canine, they are buccally impacted, then for if it is palatally impacted, the incisors. Now over here, this is an impacted canine. So now your canine is impacted in the palatal position. So these are your premolars and molars. Over here, this is premolars and molars. So now if it is palatally impacted, then what you're doing is, in this approach, what you do is you make a bilateral palatal flap from the first or the second premolar. So basically you're making a flap from first or second premolar to the first premolar. So basically you follow like this. So the incision is like this. Basically it follows the cervical line of all these teeth. But on the other side it is first premolar, and over here you can extend it on first premolar or second premolar. And then when you're raising, so this is the, for example, now this is how it is. So till first premolar, over here it is second premolar. So after that you raise this flap like this, and then you can see the tooth which is present. So basically first you will see the bone, and then there is the tooth which is present inside it. So this is the flap elevation, which was the next part of the incision. So after taking those incisions, now you raise these flaps. After this, now you have seen, now you have raised the flap. So there is this bone which is present. So now you remove this bone. This is known as gutting procedure, in which you remove the bone. Basically there are two methods of removing the bone. First is burr, and the second one is chisel and mallet. Is the aim of removing the bone. So first is the, it is to expose or uncover the crown. So it is to expose or uncover the crown, and the next is to remove the bone which is obstructing the pathway for the removal. So there are these two methods, that is burr, and the next one is chisel and mallet. So basically chisel and mallet is something like your hammer. So if you are, so if you want to put a nail into the wall, so you use this hammer and then you just tap on this nail so that it gets fitted into the wall. So this is basically nothing but the chisel and mallet. Now what is the disadvantage of this chisel and mallet? So now in this chisel and mallet, you require, like, the dentist, he should be experienced, because chisel and mallet sometimes it can, so the force sometimes it can be uncontrolled, and because of that there is more removal of the bone. Now this burr is basically you're using a handpiece that is in high speed, and this burr with the help of a burr. So burr is, you're using a number, 7 or 8 number burr, or you're using a straight number 702 or 703 carbide Fisher burr. So this is a round burr and this is a carbide burr. So these are the burrs that you can use, and the burrs, it should always be used, and there should be, like, always when you're using these burrs to remove the bone, you should always have a good saline irrigation, so that you are avoiding the thermal trauma to the bone. And so whenever you're doing this bone removal, like, you should irrigate the part with saline continuously, so that there is no necrosis of the bone. So there are basically, this is the first technique. What you're doing is, you're just in the sweeping motion, you are removing. So this is, for example, this is your round burr. So just in the sweeping motion, you're removing the bone. So your bone, it should be removed from occlusal, distal, and the buccal portion. You're not touching this, with the help of this burr, you're not going towards the mesial side or towards the lingual side. The next one is this chisel and mallet. So chisel and mallet is mostly very rarely used, and there is, the advantage of this is, there is less bone necrosis as compared to burr. Now burr, you're using it at high speed. So there is temperature. So there is high temperatures which is created in the burr technique. But in chisel and mallet, it is completely manually. So in this, there is no, like, there is less bone necrosis, but it can cause fracture of the bone. If it is not done properly, there can be fracture of the bone. So this is the second technique, that is chisel and mallet, and these are the bone removal. Now you have removed the bone. So we have seen, so there was this tooth which is present. It was covered with the bone. So now you have removed this bone over here, buccally, and you have to remove the bone so that the crown is completely visible. Now the bone is present over here. So now you have completely removed the bone. Now your tooth is visible. Now the crown of the tooth now is completely visible. After this, what you are doing is sectioning of the tooth. So now sectioning of the tooth is nothing but you are just cutting the tooth in several parts. And this is known as odontectomy. Odontectomy is nothing but sectioning of the tooth. Now what are the indications of this odontectomy? So if there is deep impacted tooth with lot of bone coverage, so you have to do odontectomy. Then if the crown, it is large, bulbous. The next one, if the root anatomy is unfavorable, if it is dilacerated or it is divergent, then the roots, they are in close proximity with the infraalveolar canal. Then if the root, if this tooth is extensively carious, in that also you're doing odontectomy. So there are various ways in which you can do the odontectomy depending upon the angulation of the tooth. So now if it is horizontally angulated, now if your tooth is horizontally angulated, so the way you are doing the odontectomy is you are sectioning it into three parts. So first part, second part and third part. So this is for horizontal. So if the tooth is in horizontal direction, then the next is if it is mesial angulated. If it is mesioangular, so in that you're just sectioning the crown into two parts. For horizontal, you're sectioning into three parts. For mesioangular, you're sectioning it into two parts. If it is vertical, then again you're sectioning into two parts, one and two. So the crown is sectioned in two parts, and then the third is this. First you remove this two parts of the crown. So first you're removing this, then you're removing this, and then you remove the root. This is how you remove and when it is distroangulated. So if your root is distroangulated, so first is this and the root, they are sectioned into two parts. So first you are removing the crown, then you are removing half of the root, and then you remove the next part of the root. So this is nothing but odontectomy. After that, you elevate the tooth. So elevators. Now elevators, you can use Cupland elevators or you can use Winter Cryer's elevator. So Cupland elevator, they are placed at the base of the crown, and Winter's elevators, they are mostly used for the mandibular teeth. So this is the diagram. Now you can see Winter's elevator is somewhat like this, and Cupland's is somewhat like this. So this is the Cupland's elevator and this is the Winter's elevator, Winter Cryer's elevator. So it has this right and left pair, this Winter's Cryer's. Then you are elevating it. Now what are the important precautions that you should take? So support the inferior border and the lingual cortex of the bone in the mandibular impaction. So if there is mandibular impaction, you need to support it properly so that at the time of elevation, you're not fracturing the bone. Then you have to support the palatal bone if there is maxillary third molar impaction and in the canine impaction, and you're supporting the neighboring tooth to prevent the luxation of the same. So these are the tooth which is present. So this is the second molar which is present. So you're just giving the support with the finger so that you're not luxating the tooth when you're removing the impacted tooth. So these are the precautions that you need to take when you are elevating. And then elevating, and this is like elevation and extraction. And the last step, next step is debridement, decontamination and smoothing of the bone margin. So first, irrigating this socket. So you're irrigating the socket, then you're curating it with the help of curettes. So the curettes, they are like, they have the shape of spoon. So you're just curating it to remove if any like dental follicle and epithelium is present. So you're curating it. So first you have irrigated it, then you're curating it, then you are going to look for the pieces of the coronal portion. If there are pieces, if the tooth, it was deeply carious, so it was carious, extensively carious, that time you will see when you're removing the tooth, it breaks into various parts, so it breaks into portions. At that time you're seeing for that if there are any coronal portions which is present. Then you're going to check for the remnants of the bone granulation tissue and if there are these bleeding points. After that, you're going to inspect for any fracture. If you're going to see properly that there is no fracture which has happened at the time of extraction of the tooth, then you're going again and again, you're just going to irrigate the socket, and after that you're going to control the bleeding before suturing. So first you're attaining this hemostasis and then you're doing the suturing procedure. And now the next is this suturing. So suture is basically you're using a 3 blacks silk suture is used, and interrupted type of sutures they are given and they are maintained for 7 days. So this is the suturing of it, and then you're just giving the post-operative instructions to the patient, you're giving the medications, and finally you're asking the patient to come for the follow-up and for the suture removal after 7 days. So the post-operative instructions, so basically now you have sutured the area, so you ask the patient to go on soft diet, then he should take all the medications which you have prescribed, that are the analgesics, antibiotics, then he should avoid gargling, spitting, smoking, then drinking with straw, then he should do warm water gargling, saline gargling after 24 hours, and these all are the instructions that you give for extraction too. For normal extraction, what all instructions that you're giving, you have to give the instruction in the same way after the surgical removal of the impacted tooth. So this was all about the surgical removal of the impacted tooth. Now what are the complications that you can see? So there can be intraoperative complications. So there can be intraoperative complication during incisions. So what happens in incision, when you are giving incisions for the molars, any vessel it can be cut at that time. And if you're giving incision in canines, so at that time incisive canal or a greater palatine vessel, it may be damaged. Then what are the complications during bone removal? So you can damage to the second molar, so you can damage to the roots of the overlying teeth, there can be slipping of the burr into the soft tissue, and there can be fracture of the mandible, as we have seen in chisel and mallet. If you are not having a proper control over it, then there can be fracture of the mandible. Now what are the complications during elevation? So in elevation there can be luxation, and because of that you're giving support to the neighboring tooth. There can be fracture of the bone, there can be fracture of the tuberosity in maxillary, then there can be slipping of the tooth into the, like any pouches, there can be temporal spaces or sublingual pouches, it can slip into that. Then there can be damage to the nasal wall, and during debridement you can damage the infraalveolar nerve or lingual nerve, or there can be damage to the maxillary sinus. So these all are the complications during the procedure. Now what are the complications that you can see post-operative? So there can be pain, swelling, there can be trismus, sensitivity. This is most commonly seen, swelling is most commonly seen when you're removing the tooth. Like if there is surgical removal of the tooth, swelling is most commonly seen. Then there can be trismus, then there can be oroanterial fistula formation, sensitivity, then there is sometimes sinus tract formation. So these all are the complications that you can see after the surgical removal of the impacted tooth. So this was it for the surgical removal of the impacted tooth. Thank you so much.